Hey, Marzouk.
How you doing, Dr. Dana?
I'm
Am I
good.
the first one in here?
Might be the only one coming tonight.
Yeah, I'm surprised.
I don't know. Isn't football, did football start yet?
Yes.
Oh,
There were some games on yesterday and last night.
okay, so I don't know how who's coming.
Okay.
So I thought I would go over some of the basics again regarding what my website is about.
Yes.
I think people don't seem to understand. There's a lot of misunderstanding about this the whole allegory of Ham, Shem, and Japheth, and their connection to different peoples of the world. And people have to understand that's not what, what the Torah was about.
Okay.
Was regarding only the people of Yemen, the people of Noah or Nu that were connected to people of Nu in Africa. And there's a whole lot that needs to be addressed with regards to that, but people are do I had to get rid of a couple of people this week who kept bringing up that allegory in terms of, the Semites being mulatto and Hamites being mulatto. I don't know if you saw the posts.
So part of it.
Yeah, some of these people. And, we really need to get out of that whole mentality or mindset that was. That's actually from the Orientalist era, and it's obsolete now.
Okay.
So this guy was talking about the tribe of Qahtan and saying something about, I didn't know if he was trying to say something about the mean Hamitic or Semitic, but part that I didn't relate to was when he started saying that they were mulatto. I don't know what that, I don't know. I guess people have different ideas. I think people are going around on different sites and learning about Shem and Ham and Japheth and trying to relate it to different tribes or people of the world, which is not what what the original writers of the Bible actually were referring to. So, for example, the early Aramaeans were Nabataeans. The speakers of Aramaic were Nabataeans. So they viewed the world, with regards to people who were related to them, not to everybody in the entire world. But what happened was people later on started to, they were Judaized, Islamicized, and adopted the different allegories regarding these names, Ham, Shem, and Japheth, which are actually the names of planetary, planets and stars and that kind of thing. Or at least Japheth, for example, Ashkenazi, that name is actually related to the Pleiades, not to, not just to some people up in Germany. Anyway, okay, let me, I guess I already put it on record, so we are already recording.
Yeah.
And I'm going to go to the post that was made me actually unfriend or block the person that because I can't have people coming on the site spouting certain things. The rhetoric that I'm trying to actually dismiss through certain research. And if I can have people that are, in Western academia are accepting this, and then the other people in maybe in Africa or, in African America are, reading certain things on the internet and not really with the program in terms of where academics are. So, for example, okay, let me just put this up. I'm going to share now. And I'm glad that you're, one of the followers, Marzouk, that can spread, help hopefully spread the truth, because I don't know, people seem to not be understanding a lot of what I'm saying. Keep asking the same questions. I have repeatedly said things about the Qahtan and the Qara and who they were and who the colonials said that they were. So these are, again, are the Qara tribe of Oman. I think this picture is from either Thesiger, who was in the 19th century, or perhaps even earlier, or else it was Bertram Thomas. But these are colonialists, meaning British colonialists, who took pictures. So it had to be, I guess, 19th century. Early pictures of the Qara. Now, Bertram says Kara, and a lot of the people in that time said Garra. Today, it's usually Qarra or Qara. But they were a famous tribe of the Yemen originally. That means they moved from the Yemen eastward into Oman. And as I explained, these were the people called Hun ibn Khuzaimah by all of the Arabic genealogists, the brethren of Kenana ibn Khuzaimah. So not only are they the tribe that is the head of the Qahtan, and actually I wanted to show, the quote from the colonialists that said that, I think it was Carter. But I've already, posted this a number of times, that the head of the Qahtan were considered to be these people, the Qara, who, according to Bertram Thomas, resembled the Beda, and according to others, resembled Somalis. So as we can see, oh, that's makes it smaller. These people did at one time resemble Somali, or at least in the, the time of Bertram Thomas. Now, as we see in the Yemen, as well as the Esir and the Hejaz, a lot of people have been coming, into these areas, especially well, in the Hejaz, in the Central Asian concubines. And in the Hejaz, according to the Ottomans, well, it was the Turkish Ottomans that came in there and saw that Medina, for example, was occupied by black skinned people. Whereas today, of course, you can't find any black people there. So let me go to this post that I'm talking about. Let's see. It says here, I'm not sure if you're seeing it, it says, "Well, sir," he's talking about me, he doesn't know I'm a woman, even though I told him, or I asked him, "Why do you think I'm a sir?" He says, "Based
Oh,
on
he was talking to you?
yeah,
Oh,
talking
okay. That's what was mixing me up.
to me."
Okay.
Yeah, mix me up too. He said, "Based on what I read, racially speaking, ancient Semites such as Assyrians, Amorites, Hebrews were not blacks." First of all, he uses the word racially, and there's no such thing as races, first of all. Secondly, the Semitic people were not a race, although the original Semites were, African people that entered Arabia and Iraq and Syria, and the languages known as Syriac, Canaanite, Hebrew were adopted by other people. The Aramaic as well. So when he says Semites were not a race, he's correct. However, the original Semitic-speaking peoples, as has been said by Christopher Ehret and other peoples, including Semitists like Joel Greenberg and other people that I've shown on my blog spot, African Asiatics or Afroasiatics were the original Semitic speaking people. They were the people that brought the culture known as and civilizations known as Semitic into Asia. So the early Akkadians were Semitic. The earliest Akkadians were Semitic or people of Akkad. The earliest Amorites or Amorim, excuse me, Amaru were Semitic because actually Amorite is a biblical name for a people called Amorat. Okay, not necessarily the same thing as Amaru. Amaru is a general term for people that were west of Mesopotamia. So Amaru included people like the Nabataeans, the people called Rabia or Rabians. Okay, these people actually came out of the Najd or Central Arabia and occupied the area west of the Euphrates and Tigris, which were named after Yemenite rivers. So there is a river Ferat, which is the original river of the Bible, mentioned in the Bible, which was transferred to that place in Mesopotamia. Most biblical names are a reference to the Yemen, except for the Assyrians who invaded the Yemen and took those people as slaves in an area, especially which was known as Babel. So the original Babylon not only was the original Tigris, Euphrates, Pishon, Gihon area in the Yemen, but this Babylon or Babylu was in the Yemen. And that's where a lot of the confusion comes in about the Jews and where they were taken and why so many African Jews claim to have come from Babylon. They're not talking about the Babylon in Iraq. They're talking about the Babylon in Southern Arabia, otherwise known as the land of Sennar. And this place is actually shown on maps, colonial maps, up until the early 20th century, Sennar in Southern Arabia, the plain of Sennar. Anyway, okay, so let's go. The ancient Egyptians did not portray, for the most part, these people in their because these people had nothing to do, they were so far south and so far west, except for the Nabataeans, who were, of course, according to the medieval Arabic sources, a black people. Okay, so these people were not really portrayed in ancient Egypt. So I'm not sure what he's talking about here, except for some of the Orientalist texts that are trying to pretend that some of these people in the Levant were Hebrews, and they weren't. And so he says, while linguistically speaking, Semitic languages belong to Afroasiatic family, which originated in Africa. Therefore, the languages are not white. Language and race are two different things. Okay, so we agree with that. As for Arabs, I believe they are a hybrid of white Joktanites or Qahtanites, Joktan, Qahtanites. Joktan was son of Shem, and an indigenous Arabia population. Okay, said to be Cushite. Okay, so he's going through back to Orientalist fallacies about who the Arabians were, and even Diop had picked up on that thinking that the people of Qahtan and Shem were not African Asiatics. Okay, that's where that comes from. So, for example, also Wesley Muhammad had mentioned in his book Black Arabia that the Sabians and Qahtan people, he had unfortunately thought that they were not African and not dark-skinned people, that they were basically white people. And I had to, talk to him about that, and he was unfortunately, well, fortunately, he said that lot of my early writings had changed his life. He thanked me for that. But already the book had already come out, Black Arabia, and this major fallacy about the Sabians being fair-skinned people was in his book. And the Sabians, of course, are descendants of Qahtan in Arabic sources and in early Arabic sources. So that whole issue about Qahtan, as I said before, Qahtan and Peleg or Falaj being fair-skinned and then Jack, or actually semi-white, and then Japhet being white and all that, it needs to be done away with. That's what I'm talking about. So this guy's calling the Hamites mulatto in appearance, whatever that means. So I don't know which Hamites he's talking about. When I see people like these, these people to me are not mulattoes. Okay, how many people are not mulatto? These same people are found, still, some of them are still found in Arabia, such as the people lingering known as Qara. Now, the Qara today, they have a lot of mulatto-looking people, but in the time of the colonialists, apparently not. Apparently not, because they kept saying that they resembled the Somalis and the Beda. So, but today you find a lot of people that look, basically like they could be a mixture of the typical, Central Asian or Persian type of person and the African type person. That's where modern Arabs in the Yemen basically descend from, both of those groups. He says, thus mulatto or Hamitic in appearance. Before the whitening by Persians, Kurds, Turks, after Islam, but even before Islam, there was a Persian invasion into Arabia, and the descendants of those invaders who settled and married Arab women are known as Banu Ahrar or Abna. Okay. Now he's saying this as if I didn't know about the Abna who I've been talking about were not indigenous to Arabia. And I said that the people that have been coming in actually since the Sassanid period, where they settled along the coast as merchants, they're brachycephalic people, unlike the Arabs and Ethiopians, who were related people that were dolichocephalic. Dolichocephalic meaning the so-called long-headed type, gracile, long-headed type that was found in ancient East Africa and Egypt. Okay. That was a major group of the Arabs. That was a major group of the Arabs, and it's still a major group of the Black Arabs in the Hadramaut and Oman area. So this is where, people tend to forget that these people did start settling in, these non-Arab, non-Semitic people did start settling into southern Iran and into the Persian Gulf and around the Arabian Peninsula at a very early time. So I agree with that part too. However, these people were not the people that were anciently called Sabians, Himyarites, and Minaeans. They were not the Semitic people, is what the point is. So he's confusing modern day peoples with, the ancient Arab peoples of the Torah, who were in fact the peoples known as the children of Joktan or Qahtan. Joktan and Peleg, children of Shem. These were the original Semites. It says, besides, I don't consider Arabs as a race, even if they once were. They changed being one since the pre-Islamic era to me. Arabian society consists of various Semitic peoples. Okay, first of all, I don't like the way he's talking as if he's, the be all end all know-it-all of, who the Semitic people were, but, he happens to be right. He's not a scholar, though, and he shouldn't be writing like this unless he's backing it up with sources. What they had and still have in common is Arabic. The story of that all Arabs descended from Qahtan and Adnan is just a myth. This is my opinion, but stronger evidences is always welcome. Okay, so I had to, say bye-bye to him because he apparently didn't know that my whole page was about this very subject that he's talking about. Not only this, but the blog spot, Aphrodisiac's blog spot, is about the Qahtan and their descendants, the Hebrews and Berbers. Because as all of the Berbers stated and the Arabs stated, and I'm talking about the real Berbers, the authentic Berbers that came from Yemen, and as well as the Tuareg that originally came from Yemen and from the Adites. Okay. So I'm just, bringing his text up because I don't want people to get confused with the Orientalist mythology that he's speaking about here, and this idea of Semites being fair-skinned people or mulatto, or the Hamites being mulatto or darkened Caucasians, whatever. Okay, that should be, I went into that about 20 years ago. I'm not going back into that. Let me just put up here. Okay. Hey, do you have any questions, Marzouk?
No, I read that whole exchange there, and I actually pulled up the your blog spot page, and that's where I just searched Beja
Yeah, okay.
and saw just how dark they were.
Right.
So
Yeah.
yeah, and they were the archers too, is that correct?
Yeah, they were the archers, the
Yeah.
Qara, El Qara were the archers of the Yemen, which is on
Okay.
the same latitude as Sudan. And the Qara, as I mentioned, are the people that settled Somalia and brought the names of many of the modern Somali clans. In other words, the same clans in Arabia of the Qara that the colonialists mentioned are also found in Somalia today. So, for example, the Isa are one of the clans. You remember who the Isa corresponded to? What does it sound like?
Esau in the Bible.
Yes.
You're talking about Edom.
Esau.
Esau.
Which is
Yeah.
Edom. Edom, Edom. So Esau, according to the colonists, were the clan that whose name actually meant Esau. Esau. Okay.
So.
The word Esau is connected to the name of a goat. Most names of these Semitic peoples, i.e., the Afro-Asiatic peoples, were the names of totem animals or fauna because they were African-related peoples. The peoples called Qara, as well as the other related peoples in Yemen, the Mahra, the Afar, Harises, Keturah, Katiri, okay, who are Keturah. All these clans, well, they said, except for the Harises, whose core is the Afar people in colonial times. In other words, in colonial times, the people called Afar were a major tribe in Hadjamelt and were the core of the Harassis people connected to the Qatura or Qatiri, Al-Qatiri or Beit Qatiri. These Al-Qatiri are the Qatura incense traders of Median. That is where Median was, in the Yemen. Okay, so when Josephus says they crossed over into Africa and colonized troglodyte Ethiopia, meaning the area of Somalia, that is why he said it. The Afar are people in Eritrea, Somalia, Ethiopia. The Afar and other Somali people, they're also in Djibouti, or Djibouti, which is supposed to be connected to the name of the Gebedai and Gibeon, or the Gibeon, Gabaon people in the Minaean era, known as Gibeon. Anyway, getting away from that. These people in Somalia are still the most prolific incense traders in the world. Okay, that was one of the main modes of culture of the Keturah people. Supposedly, the word Keturah means incense. Okay, so these are great traders in frankincense and myrrh. Frankincense came from this area of the world, not other areas of the world, not other areas of the world. Okay, so these Midianite traders, the Afar, the Jephar, the Enoch, or Ankala, otherwise still known as Danakil, were the people that were the great traders between the Yemen and Somalia. Both sides of the Red Sea, everything east of the Nile in Africa was considered Arabia, period. In the era of the Greeks, everything in Arabia east of the Nile was considered Arabia. The people that were called Arab in that time and the Africans east of the Nile were the same exact people, known by the same names. Those are the people that crossed over into the Sahel and Sahara and into North Africa, and had been doing so since probably before the first millennium BC, because that's when, according to the Tuareg, well, it was around 9 centuries before Alexander the Great, according to the Tuareg, that their ancestors came from Canaan into, or land of the Philistines, into Africa. Okay, so let me get back to the Qara. As I've mentioned before, the Qara tribes of Saab in Oman, we're talking about still, Oman and Yemen. Saab, Machir, or Machir. Tamim, or Tamim, as it later became known. Tamim, or Taman in the Bible. The Jobub or Jobab in the Bible. All these are people of Edom and Esau. Another group was the Jushain, or excuse me, Jashon, otherwise known as Dishon in the Bible, in the Torah. Okay, so what I said was that these Qara people, who were the head of Qahtan, were also the ancestors of the peoples of Ham, the peoples of Edom, and the Canaanites. They were connected to the Canaanites. They originally came from Yemen or the Tahama area. Now, it is, I think, Bertram Thomas has said that the Qara and the Afar and other groups had traditions that they came from Africa. It was either him or another colonial writer. So these Semitic people, whose dialects are the closest related to the ancient Sabian and Mennean, aside from the Ethiopian ones, because the Ethiopian dialects apparently are even closer related than these Qara people still in Arabia. These are the last of the peoples of Shem. The last of the peoples of Shem that are in Arabia. So if people, if there are people in Arabia that don't look like them, they have nothing to do with the original Semites, period. Okay, so in Arabian tradition, there's no such thing as Ham, Shem, and Japheth, the three different peoples and ancestors of different colored peoples that went to different parts of the world. No such thing. So people have to distinguish between the writings of the Adnah or Ajam, people that were not Arab by origin, and the people called Arab and Samayu or Qahtan. All these Semitic peoples that literally took the language that was basically African, an African language, into Syria and Babylon, even further north. Those people are not related necessarily to modern Arabs. Well, modern Arabs, I'm sure, have a lot of them have, Arab blood, or the blood of the ancient genuine Arab in them. But the ancient genuine Arab basically was an African. Now, the name, as I said, of Africa itself comes from these people in Arabia that settled back in Africa. The Afar people, the Afarik and Ephraim. All right. So I was looking at a paper I think I had wrote for academia.edu about the Qara. Just to give you an example of what different colonialist people said about the Qara. Okay, so this guy says in a recent book, 2004, more recent, European observers have made much of their physical resemblance to Somalis and Ethiopians, but there is no historical evidence of any connection. They speak a South Arabian language akin to the languages of the ancient Yemeni kingdoms of Himyar, Ma'an, and Saba, and not mutually intelligible to speakers of modern Arabic. Okay, so he's talking about the fact that they speak an early Semitic dialect. It's called Sahadic. Okay, but he is wrong in saying that there's no historical evidence of any connection. Okay, both sides of the Nile were occupied, excuse me, both sides of the Red Sea were occupied by the same people. The Qara people actually are just one of the peoples of the Qahtan that occupied the Tahama. And Tahama is where the Afro-Asiatic civilization began. Tahama and Aden, Aden. This is where the culture on both sides of the Red Sea was the same for thousands of years. Okay, here's another silly sentence. One book entitled Arabia Without Sultans by somebody, Fred Holliday. I'm not sure when the original book was, but it says 2013. Probably it's a more recent book because Orientalists wouldn't have said something so ridiculous. He says they are possibly descended from Ethiopian Christians who conquered South Arabia before the coming of Islam. Okay, so Evidently, they look so African that he calls them Ethiopian Christians. So anybody who knows anything about medieval Arabia knows that the Qara are mentioned as the archers of the Arabs. Okay. Says so real the people that knew about Arabia, the Orientalists, right? So for example, Balfour here. Oh, are you looking able to see this or no? Whatever.
No, I'm still on the
Okay.
car and sitting next to that wall.
Okay, that's not where I am. How about now?
Okay.
You see the name Balfour?
Yes.
Okay. So Balfour was an early Orientalist. He claimed the Al-Qara emigrated from Yemen to Oman, a tribe well known for its skill in archery. The reason he claims this is because all of the early Arabic sources tell us that they were the archers that nobody could beat. Okay. It says, in fact, in one tale in the collection of stories entitled Faraj Bad al-Shida, they are mentioned as a Yemenite people whose arrows never miss the mark. Okay. That was quoted by another, well, by a scholar, Semitist. The Semitist actually is one who criticized Kamal Salibi's work. Okay. So Beeston also talks about they formed a corps of elite in the service of the kings of Yemen. One day, a strange horseman appeared and cried out, "Where are those who hit the mark?" He issued a challenge to them. Whereupon the Arab said, "Ansafa al-Qarata man ramaha." Whoever challenges an Al-Qara man to archery has done justly or has been fair. Okay, so Beeston is just quoting from the Arab sources that are talking about the legendary archery bowman skills of the Qara. Okay. These Al-Qara were the same people that call themselves Kanana. Okay. Even today, or excuse me, even in colonial times, the Qara said that they were Quraysh. And the reason they say that is because originally the Quraysh came from the Kanana ibn Khuzaimah, okay, who was the brother of these Hun and the ibn Khuzaimah, which was another name for the Qara. So the Qara and the Quraysh were basically the same people. So if you want to see what the Quraysh looks like and why there are still black people calling themselves Quraysh in Sinai, in Jericho, and in the Gar region of Jordan, that is why. That's what the Quraysh were. Remember the Kanana, what Marzuk, who did the Kanana tribe? What name do we know in the Bible as Kanana?
Canaanites or Canaan.
Right. Very good. Okay. Please. Glad you remember that. Okay. So Kanana and Kara and the Huthael or Huzael were all described as black people. Huzael bin Ibn Mudrika, okay, because Kanana Ibn Khuzaimah is the son of Mudrika as well. All those people lived in the area of Hejaz and south of Mecca, or around Mecca actually, just like the Aus, Khazraj, and other groups of the Az tribe and Sulaym, excuse me, Sulaym and Hawazin lived around Medina or Yathrib, named after Jethro. All right, so the same thing here. Lisan al-Arab of Ibn Manzur in the 13th century claimed that the Al-Qara were a tribe amongst Banu Kanana known for its skill in archery. The Kanana, who in the Bible are called the Canaanites, Al-Qara, who are probably the Korah, but of Edom, but I can't say for sure right now. The Hudael, who are also one of their main clans, is the Lohian or Lehianites. Okay, that name comes from Lehi, one of the minor prophets of the Bible. And the Lehianites were people that were in the region of Dedan in the southern part of Saudi Arabia. Okay, so again, like Yaqub ibn Rabihu also said in Ikt al-Farid, Al-Hun ibn Khuzaimah were Al-Qara, and they were the sons of Al-Hun ibn Khuzaimah ibn Mudrika. Al-Qara were the best marksmen among the Arabs, and about them it was said, whoever has a shooting match with Al-Qara is fair to them, meaning just, is just to them. Okay, so I've talked about how Charles Doughty in his travels in Arabia, or whatever it was called, Hudhail ibn Mudrika, Kanana ibn Khuzaimah ibn Mudrika, Asad ibn Khuzaimah ibn Mudrika, Al-Hun ibn Khuzaimah ibn Mudrika. Okay, all those tribes were descended from someone, an ancestor called Ilyas. Ilyas was the brother of Ilnas or Qais ibn Aylan. So this name Aylan is important because it's one of the people that came, the Aylan came into the area of Jordan and named the Gulf of Ayla or Aylan. It is also the name that the Bible intended to mean, to represent. It's actually related to the word Hit, of the Elan of the Hittites. Elan. So I had mentioned several times before that this Charles Doughty, let me see if I can find his book. He calls them the Hatil. The Hatil, and says that they were had black and shining skins. His book is called Travelers in Arabia Deserta, and it was written in 1888. So I had mentioned before, now if you go northward into Sinai and Palestine, you'll find people by the same name, the Hudhail, who claim to be from, these Hudhail of the Hejaz. Hejaz meaning the area where the sacred precincts of Islam were, Mecca, Medina, and Jeddah. However, those people in Palestine and Sinai today now are not, do not possess black and shining skins. And this is the problem. It's not a problem, but this is what happened to all of the, a lot of the Arab tribes, because they were such slave traders that a lot of their, and they did, they actually married their concubines or actually had children with their concubines. And if the child was, the child being of the Arab father was considered, an Arab. So now we have many people claiming around, the Middle East that they are Arabs and they are fair-skinned, which is fine. But it is a mistake to think that that's how the Arab looked 500 years ago. Because even 500 and 600 years ago, the Syrians themselves said there were very few people in the Hejaz that were fair-skinned. And those that were considered descendants of slaves. Al-Dhahabi lived, he was a Syrian, he lived only 600 years ago in the 1400s. Okay, so in the, let's see. So none of the Arab tribes, literally none of the Arab tribes, about 600 years ago were anything but dark skinned. But what happened was after the slave trade was cut off from Constantinople, where they were bringing in a lot of people from Circassia and all those places, then you start to find people from Africa coming in, from actually not so much from the Sudan as from the south of Sudan, from the Zanj area, so-called Zanj area, which was in fact named for an Arab tribe. All right, so here we have, let me share, new share. Okay, so we know that the Let's just start from here. Lagasan. Okay. Lagasan were the tribe of the Azd, down way down here. And early it came up in the Christian era, just like Lahim, the Banu Lahim from the Yemen. There's still tribes named a tribe named Banu Lahim, Lahim in the Yemen, and that's where, according to Arab sources, they came from. The Lagasan were from the Azd. The Lahim were from the Azd, and the Azd were a group of the Madij. So sometimes the Lahim are described as people, or the genealogy takes them directly from the Madij or Midaj. Here they are, Midaj here. In the this is Jauf area of Yemen, or this, yeah, or maybe Najran. I forget which one this area is. Anyway, the Ghassan are the people called Kishon or Kushan, Midianites. And they come from the area of Hodeidah down here in the Yemen. So this is a map from, let's see, it was early medieval times. It's not supposed to meant today, but let's see. it's from the time of when Ghassan was ruling and Lahim was ruling, 600 AD. And over here we see the Sassanid Empire. And the Sassanid Empire, which is an Persian, Iranian, actually late Persian, the time when this, basically people that had been known originally as Scythians had taken over from the original darker skinned Persian people, known as Medes and Achaemenids and Dahai, or in India they're called the Dasa, people who built Tripura or three walled fortresses, okay, part of the Namazgha culture, Namazgha four culture. That preceded the Scythian peoples who entered Iran or Persia. Okay, so these people came late not only to Iran or Central Asia, but into the southern Babylon. Anyway, okay, let's go here. Aniza, the Aniza claimed descent from Madij, just to let you know. The Bakr bin, though they're actually related to the Bin Wael, that in the Bin Wael, Bakr bin Wael, Tagli bin Wael, and those groups of Central Arabia originated in Yemen. Here's Taglib right here. Numair ibn Wa'l ibn Qasit was one of their tribes. It is that tribe that was said to have taken over Babylon. The name is the origin of the word Nimrod, son of Cush. Now, that being said, remember there were two Babels or Babylons, and Babiru or Babylon was the name of the area of southern Arabia, as well as this area of the Tigris-Euphrates or Fertile Crescent further north. And the tribal names in the Central Arabian and Southern Arabian area are the same as those in Mesopotamia in ancient times. So you find the Banu Yamin there, you find the Yahar tribe there, you find the Benjamin, or I already said the Benjamin, you might find the Bin Samal, okay? The Bin Samal, who also were, of course, that's also the name of the Somalis. That's where the name Somali comes from. So all these tribes lived around the Persian Gulf and settled in Mesopotamia in early times by, the second end of the second millennium BC. Unfortunately, because the chronology of this place as well as Egypt is so messed up, we tend to push it back way back 1,000 years earlier. But it was probably sometime around the middle of the second millennium BC that these people started settling there. And they were also settling in South Arabia, known as the Mayans or Ma'in, Ma'an. It's actually Ma'in, Ma'in. Mayan or Ma'in. And that is where the word you find in the Bible about Lut, the Banu Lut, or the tribe of Lut, and his connection with Ammon and Ma'on. Okay. And the Moabites, these were where the Moabites originated in this area of southern Arabia, southwest Arabia, supposedly the Jalf region of Yemen. There's two Jalf regions, there's one in Yemen, and there's one further north where you find a Dumath, and there's also this one down further south where you find Adumatu, which is the original Adam or Edomite people. That's where they lived. Okay, so, okay, we have the Bara here. Remember, these tribes can be grouped into certain medieval confederations. So, for example, and also in early Christian times, you have the tribe of Kuda, meaning leopard, related to the Kindah down here in Hadhramaut. These people settled in Christian early, a few centuries before the Christian era, in the Levant and in Jordan, and were called Kalb or Caleb. That's where the biblical name Caleb comes from. They're called Sala or Shelah, because in the Torah, Shelah is related to Caleb. There's the Bahra, and in the Tahama they were called Bahran, or Al, in the Bible they're called Aran, actually. So these Bahran people also had moved to the Persian Gulf, where they named Bahrain. And the Jotam or Judam tribe were of the Azd, but the Udra were of the Kuda tribe. Okay, so Kalb or Caleb, Shelah, Aharon, and Ezra, because this is the word Ezra in the Bible, in the Torah, Ezra or Ezra, Udra, were all part of the tribe known as Kuda. Kuda is also connected to what's known as Abu Ma'ad, or Father Ma'ad. Father Ma'ad, or Abu, or excuse me, Ma'ad was the group that came out of the Yemen and settled in Hejaz, but the Romans knew them as the Madinoi. And in the Greek, they're known as the Madiani, and that is where you get the word Midianite. So by the Byzantine era, which is before 600 AD, you find the Ma'ad tribe moving north from the Yemen into Hejaz, into in the Asir area. These Madinoi people were north, just north of the Himyarites or Humer, where you get the word Hamor, the Canaanite. So we have Ezra, we have Jotham or Jotham, which was a king in Israel. If you look it up, Jotham was a king in Israel. You have the Shia, or Saleh, was a very important figure in Islamic history, connected with the she camel and with the Thamud. The Thamud people, otherwise known as Dumath or Idumeans, or Duma, which was one of the tribes of Ishmael. Okay, they also had settled in this area. That's why the present day people, Banu Saleh, claim descent from Thamud. Of course, the Saleh, Sawalhian, are described as near black in color, living in the Tur area of the Negev or Sinai in colonial times. You probably still are there. Okay, so Ezra, this area of Ezra or Udra was called the land of the wanderers. Oh, hold on. Wandering. The wandering land of the Banu Israel. Because, of course, Ezra was very important Judean Israelite. Another tribe of the Kuda was called Bali or Bela or Billa, and they occupied the whole entire area. Well, now they're the ones in colonial times that were located in the Gaur that are called children of Lut. Children of Lut, or Lot, the biblical Lot. And that's why I was saying that when these people, some of these people came as Arabs in the Muslim, Muhammadan era, when they were invading after the 9th century, after the 8th century AD, these people came in and, migrated across North Africa. And became, when they settled in Iberia, that's why they start talking about these groups as Moabites or Moabitarum. But the original Moabites, I mean, they are Moabites, obviously, because the names of the Gaur area, which is in Transjordan and south of the Dead Sea, all those people, the five main tribes of the Moabites, five main centers of the Moabites are also listed in this area. It's also called the Balka, named after Balik, or excuse me, Balik is the Arabic form of Balak, the Moabite. And Bela, or these Bili people get their name from Balaam or Balaam. So it's a long, if you don't know who the Moabites are, though, of course, you're not going to be able to understand what I'm talking about. If you don't know, for example, that Moab had certain, certain towns that were associated with them, like Beit Shan, Zohar. All those names are found in this area of Jordan extending to the Haran. And of course, as I mentioned in, many times and in my book, these towns were occupied in the 10th century by black woolly-haired people. So in case we forget, Yakut al-Hamawi, let me share, stop and share. So Yakut al-Hamawi, I'm not sure what century he is, I forget, but it's not any time in recent 500 years. Hold on, Yakut al-Hamawi, Yakut. I should know that. One second. A very well-known writer. 13th century, okay. Aleppo. Or 1178, which means in the Muslim time. No, I'm sorry. He was born 1178 in Christian era and died in 1229 in Syria. Born in Anatolia, meaning he probably wasn't even Arab, or he might have had, he was a Muslim scholar of Byzantine Greek ancestry. That's what it says in Wikipedia. Okay, so never mind. Okay, Yakut al-Hamawi in the 13th century wrote that Beit Shan, a town of the Moabites, well-known town of the Moabites, town of the Jordan province in the Gaur, who were brown-skinned and woolly-haired, whose people were brown, I should say, whose people were brown-skinned and woolly-haired. Okay, it says, well, anyway, that this Beit Shan is not the one that the Bible talks of, though. However, these people brought their names into Jordan and south of the Dead Sea. And that is why, they're called Moabites. So the Beli and the and or Bali and the Hamada tribes are generally known as the tribes that broke and were, broke what is called the Moabite stone. The Moabite stone, which the British, I guess, they wanted. And I think they ended up breaking it on purpose or something like that. So it also in this Jordan Valley area of Gaur, you'll find the Canaan people. Again, the real Canaanites. But these people came from the Gezawiya of Sinai. In other words, they moved up there from the Gezawiya of Sinai in Hejaz. Who actually, there's Gezawiya or Gaza people came from further south. So these Gezawiya people, or Canaan people of the Gezawiya, also founded Sikra or Gur Sikra in North Jordan and the nearby Ajalon or Ajalon. This name Ajalon is Eglon in the Hebrew Bible. But again, all these places were brought, names were brought up from further south in the Yemen. Anyway, I wrote all about this in the book, The African and Arabian Origins of the Hebrew Bible. Okay. So this land of the Balka, named for Balak, the Moabite Balak, became known as the land of, it was considered part of the land of Ham. It includes what's called Jund, Philistine, and Palestine. The Valley in Jericho, Beit Shan, Gur Mazra, and Gur Safia, or what was in the medieval era called Jund Philistine. Okay, so that's where all these black people that are in the area occupied these areas. Okay, just in case you don't believe me, several Orientalists have quoted the 12th century Al-Idrisi, who said, Al-Ghur includes Diyar Qaum Lut, the country of Lot's people, and the Stinking Sea, which is, they're talking about the Dead Sea, being all the land of Zugar up to Baisan and Tiberias, Zohar, and Beit Shan. Okay. All the waters of Syria descend into it and are collected there, forming one mighty stream whose origin is the Lake of Tiberias near the city of Tabaria. Okay, so that was by a colonialist writer in the 1851 period. Hey, what does he say about, however, it says, hold on. Okay, one translation of Al-Idrisi continues. He talked about Moab and Beth Shan. The other rivers of Syria flow into the Jordan, such as the Nahr al-Yarmouk, Hiramax, the streams of Baisan or Beit Shan, and those which flow from the district of Moab, and the mountains of the holy city, and the mountains of Abraham's sepulcher, Hebron. Peace be upon him, as also what waters come down from the Nablus. Okay, keeps going on about Lake of Zuhar or Zohar, the Dead Sea, and Jericho. It says Jericho with Amta and Beit Shan are the finest of the cities of the Gaur. The principal crop of the Gaur is indigo. Of course, indigo is the color near purple. It is the Phoenician purple of the Greek writers. The inhabitants are brown-skinned, and some of them are even or are almost black. That's what Al-Idrisi said, who lived in the 9th century. So this guy who wrote this, Kennedy, Hugh Kennedy, is quoting this guy who translated Al-Idrisi's work. Guy Lestrange quoted Al-Idrisi, Guy Lestrange, in the 1800s. Just make sure Al-Idrisi lived. Okay, now he's the he was born in Ceuta, which I think was in, where was that? In Spain. No, sorry, it was a Spanish city on the north coast of Africa. I think it was Tunisia. I can't remember if it was Tunisia or where. But Al-Idrisi is very famous. He wrote in the 1100s, not 9th century AD, the 1100s or 12th century AD. Okay, so still near. It was still 900 years ago, or near 1,000 years ago, he's writing. And he says that the people in that region, but I mean, I don't know why I'm saying that because the people are still in that region are still dark brown, dark brown. I've been showing them on my website. Okay. So these Moabite people brought their names with them into this area south of the Dead Sea. Yakubi said that the name of Belka was from Balik. Of course, that's just the Arabic word for Balak. Again, Balak was a Moabite, king of Moab. The reason the Belka region of the Gora is also, according to some encyclopedias of the Bible, the land of the Ammon or Ammonites. It is not improbable the area of Belka or Balik was named by the Bela people or Bellona, or their tribe Bani Lut. Okay. So we said that the Beli tribe are the same people that were miners. Okay, this is I'm gonna end with this because so that you know people don't this is a lot of information again. These tribes of Beli or Belawi were miners of the Sulayn people. Okay, the ruling tribes of the Sulayn had these Bela as vassals. The Bali or Bela were Kuta peoples. Kuta was a tribe that was subject to the Sulayn since they were in South Arabia, actually. The Sulayn are the peoples known in the Bible as Shalmai as well, children of Manasseh. That's why they're called Sulaym ibn Mansur. So they occupy parts of the Hara, which includes parts of the Horan. But they were the mining, the people in control of the mines between Sinai and Iraq, all those mines. Not only that, but these people came into Egypt and Sudan. In fact, most of the tribes of Sudan are closely related to either Kuta or Sulaym. The Sulaym, who are called black as lava, and the Beli, who occupied Nubia, originally as Blemies or Bilam, Blemies in Nubia, and but later on in Muslim times they were called Balawi or Bali, Al-Balian. And Ibn Khaldun said they were the people that occupied Sinai and Yathrib, where they came from Sinai and Yathrib, or named after Jethro, otherwise called Medina. Among these Balauna or Bali people were the people called Balkane. These Balkane are in the Torah, are called Kenites. And as I said, those are the people that brought the worship of Yahweh to the, to people of the world, actually. They're the reason that people worship Yahweh. So basically, the Kenites were associated with mining and smithing, masonry, smithing, and Josephus refers to these Kenites. Well, the Targums refer to the Sulaym as Kenites because they're part of the Belkane were part of the Bali who were vassal client tribes of the Sulaym. So the Targums refer to the Sulaym tribes as Kenites. Whereas Josephus calls the Kenites Sheshemites. He calls them of the Sheshemite people. So that's why in ancient Yemen, in the ancient Yemen, you have two tribes mentioned in inscriptions called the Al-Sukaima And hold on, let me see. Anyway, let's see. So it's just important to know that these also came a tribes. And the Bali, excuse me, the Balkane, the Udra or Ezra, the Bali or Bela, otherwise known as Belam, because Bela was a tribe of Benjamin as well. But it's the same group. Okay, and that's where you get the connection to Janus, Janus, and Jembarith. These were the smiths of the pharaohs, otherwise called Farain bin Bali. So pharaoh, when they're talking about that is not the name of ancient Egyptian rulers. The ancient Egyptian rulers did not call themselves pharaohs. It is the Amalekite people of Mizraim, who were from Yemen. Mizraim was a place in Yemen, had nothing to do with what's called Kemet today, or United Arab Republic of Egypt, even though those Amalekites did apparently take over Egypt at one time. So the Kuta War, hold on, I guess I'm not sharing this. The Kuta tribes were again Juhana, connected to the word Gihon, but also Janus, Johannes, otherwise called the Apostle John's name comes from that, just in case people are interested in Christian aspect. Udra is the name, Arab name for what's called in the Bible Ezra. You have Bali or Bela, again connected to Balaam. Let's see, hold on. Okay. Hey, Greg.
Hey.
Okay. Well, we're almost done right now, but okay. So we were talking about the different groups of Kuta and their connection to, let's see. Hope this is where I was. Connection to the Moabites and to the right now we're talking about the connection to the Africans called Blemmyes and Bali who lived in Nubia. So okay, the Kuta tribes included the Juhana, again connecting to Johannes or Janus, and at Udra or Ezra. Balaam, Bahra was otherwise known as Bahran, and in the Bible called Aharon. Bahra, let's see, Aaron, and I think it's Bildash, Aaron. I can't remember exactly where he fits in, but I think he's one of the Edomites. And then Kalb or Caleb in the Bible, Alkane or the Kenites of the Bible. I don't know about Tanukh, but Saleh or Shelah of the Bible, who was connected to Caleb, the first judge of Israel or Judah. And the Nod, Banu Nod, who were the same, in the Bible, you'll see the land of Nod mentioned, Nod, it's written. So these people settled in Nubia and were the miners between the Eastern Sudan, Sinai, and Yathrib. And I was saying that that Ibn Khaldun referred to them, the Bali in Nubia or Bella, as coming from Yathrib or Medina and Sinai. I'm going to turn my. Can everybody hear me well? Because I forgot. Some people were saying that I was speaking so low last time they could barely hear me.
No, I can hear you clearly.
Oh, great, great, okay. Okay, so this is actually a paper I'm working on now. You're going to be able to find out some of this information or know some of this information about the Belkane or Kenites and their connection to the Africans before other people. Although I've already written about this in my book, a lot of it, a lot of it. But let's see. As I said, the Kuta were a vassal tribe of the Sulayn, but they were also intermingled with them. So they're sometimes called, considered a, genealogically part of the Sulayn. However, they're basically, as I said before, from Abu Ma'ad. Or Abu, wait, hold on. Abu Kuta is called Ma'ad, or the father of Kuta is called Ma'ad. Ma'ad. And I said that the Ma'ad were called Madanoi or Saracen Madanoi in the Byzantine period. In the Greeks period, they called them the Madianoi. And that is where the name Medianite comes from. And this is where the idea of the Midianites being in Jordan and further north than Mecca comes from. So these people.
Wow. I just said, wow.
And so these people of the Kuta, the leopard, are the worshipers of Yahweh, or they include the worshipers of Yahweh called Cain. The Sulayn that were settled around Medina also included the Cain who were in Yathrib. So that's why you see in you see, people talking about the Jews in Medina were called Cainuca. So the Cainuca were a part of the Kuta tribe. They were worshipers of Yahweh. And I was saying how these people are first mentioned. In southern Arabia. Okay, so they're all, as I said, Cain is connected with metalworking and smithing and mining. And hold on. Let me just see where I talk about. Yeah, their original name is El Cain bin Jasser or Yasra. Yasran. The Yasran people of southern Yemen actually settled in Abyssinia as well, and they were the early bronze workers there. That was in the 8th century BC that they settled in Abyssinia. And there's archaeological specialists who talk about them, the Yasran people. So again, the Beltane were by medieval times, a group of the Bella or Billa, who are called in the Bible Bella, son of Benjamin, as well as Bilam. Okay. The ancestor is actually Bilam. Now, Bilam is also called in Arabic sources Lukman, just to let you know. It's a man of the vultures, and name Bilam also means the same thing. So, in ancient South Arabia, you find in the Middle Sabian period of 1000 BC, the clan of Kabr Kainim, or Cain and Sukaim, which again is the name for the Sheshemite people. That is why Josephus said that the Kenitides were the race of the Sheshemites. Sheshem was a son of Hamor, the Hivite. The name Hamor is the equivalent of Humer or Himyar, which was the land in the land of Canaan, actually, which was, as I say, in Yemen, not in the Levant. So these Hivite people, the Kenites, All these people came from the Canaanites. So let's see. That's why I had asked last week or a couple weeks ago that everybody learn the names of the groups of Canaan, the names of the 12 groups of Israel. So Hamath was, for example, a group of the Hamathites were a group of the Canaanites. And here in the Bible, it talks about how these Canaanites are from Hamath, the father of the Rechabites. Okay. The Rechabites, the Hamathites, the Kenites are all people that are ancestors of these people. It says in the Torah, Salma, again, as I said, the Salma were the people of Sulaim ibn Mansur, whose children were Beit Lahim or Bethlehem, the Netuphim or Netuphites, Ataroth, the house of Joab, the Manahathites, the Zorites, and the clans of scribes who lived at Jabez, the Tirathites, the Shemathites, the Sukkothites. These are the Kenites who came from Hamath, the father of the Rechabites. So as you can see, all these people are children of Judea. We're talking about the Judeans who lived between the Assyria area and, the Southern Arabian area. See. So I'm just going to read from my paper here that I was working on. The Rechabites were found by a colonialist named Wolf in the area of Sana'a, where they are spoken of as the Bini Arhab. Arhab is Rechab. They were also called the children, they call themselves the children of Jundub or Jonadab, meaning grasshopper, which is also the name of the tribe of Tai of the Madij in Yemen. And the name is also affiliated with Yindibu, who was an ancient Arab chief, one of the first mentioned by the Assyrians. So the Assyrians, when they invaded these people of Kedar, people like that, they're talking about Southern Arabia, not North Arabia. So all these people were people of the Yemen, even the Banu Hur, who according to our genealogy were the brethren of the Jundub tribe. The Tai clan were a clan of Madij, sometimes said to be the brethren of Madij, otherwise the son of Madij. Madij is called Udad, Malik ibn Udad, or Udadis. That's where the word Udadis comes from. Okay, I just want to ask, does anybody remember what's important about the Madij? What they said about what who could never be an Arab?
Fair-skinned people.
Fair-skinned people.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yes. So Ibn Rabihu in the 14th century, an Arabized person of Cordoba wrote that a judge in the 7th century of the Madij, meaning these ancient Semitic people, Afro-Asiatic people had people called judges who were, very important, like almost as important as the chiefs there. So the Madij had a judge that said this. He said that the Madij, there could never be, a fair-skinned Arab. It was inconceivable. Now he was probably making a joke, I guess, because he said also that they were, that was as rare as one of the seven wonders of the world. Okay. And also the leader of the Madij, who had the so-called false prophet, his name was El Ansi, Aswad El Ansi, and he was called so according to the Arabicized writers of that time because he had a black face. Now at this time there were a lot of people from Central Asia coming into the Yemen, and the Yemenites had been called in, excuse me, the these people had been called in to fight against the Madij during Muhammad's time. And that is why you find this reference to black, you know, black and white. You know, the Medes are making fun of the these Iranians, and Iranians are saying, calling Alansi the, you know, Aswad Alansi, because a real Arab would never have said Aswad Alansi, right? That's something that the foreign people are talking about, this true or genuine Arab guy. So the Medes were black, and I told you that the Murad tribe today, that is still near black in color in many places, is one of the main tribes of the Medes in ancient times. Not only in ancient times, but pre-Islamic inscriptions. They're also called Yuhabir. They also occupy Somalia. So the Mered are the Mered, Mered of the Torah. See. So, according to Wolf, the tribe of Bnei Israel of the Dan lived with them. I said these Dan are undoubtedly the Dan tribe still present in Hadramaut of southern Yemen, and the same tribe that the Havan or Habaniya claimed descent from. The Habaniya Jews that were the still wear the side locks that were also worn by people like the Fulani, actually, Wahdabi Fulani in Africa. And I've shown many pictures of the Haban tree. The authentic Alban are very dark skinned. They're not, they're mixed with, some of them are mixed with the Central Asian Persian kind, but basically the Habaniya were an Ethiopian looking people. They also occupy Sudan. And they also occupy Sinai among the Salamian groups there, or the Sawarka Salamian. Salamian means Sulaim. Okay, so the Sulaim originally, again, were a tribe of the Hara, described as, anybody remember?
What was the question?
The Sulaim were a tribe of the Hara, or of Hara, which is the volcanic area in certain places of Arabia and Syria. There's thousands of kilometers of Hara extending into Syria. And Al-Jahiz said, what about the Sulaim and the tribes of the Hara? Not, I didn't say it then. I said it. I've said it many times before about
The talking about the Kenites.
I'm talking about the Sulaim bin Mansur.
Manasseh. Well, I know they're connected to Manasseh.
Yeah.
That's not the answer you're looking for, though.
I'm looking for how were the Sulaim ibn Mansur described?
Black as lava.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, that's 2-1. I'm just kidding. Okay, okay, Greg, don't hide back there. No, but okay, so yeah, so that's
Definitely
so no, but it's good that everybody knows again and again how these people were described, because a lot of people are saying that, you know, African Americans are making up things to make themselves feel good. So, you know, I'm just saying it's important to remember the documented sources. It's Al-Jahiz in the 9th century who writes about that. Al-Jahiz, who said the Sulaim and all of the tribes of the Hara were the color of lava, and so were their cattle, their animals, you know, sheep and all. So the Sulaim or Salamian, as I had mentioned in my blog spot, are actually found among these people called the Hawatate and the Harb, both of whom are descendants of ancient Yemenites. The Hawatate name comes from the name Hatita, which is in the found in the Bible as one of the Judean tribes. The Hawatate claim descent from Hawait bin Ibn Ham. That is the name of the Hivites. Hawait is the name of the Hivites. So the Hamathites, and all these groups of Canaanites were the people who are still, some of them are still somewhat black, but in ancient times, the Canaanites, were known as black people in Syrian sources. It's the Syrian people and the Greek people that wrote about the Canaanites being black. So we don't have to, we don't have to pretend that they're something that they're not. They're still people like the Houd, Hale, and the Qara are still black people in Arabia. And the Kanana people I talked about in the Gar, part of the Al-Ghazi, are still black. Okay, so another Kenite clan, which happens to be the name of a clan of the valley, is Hobab. And this name is also found in the Yemen in the ancient inscriptions as Dhu Habab. Okay. In the province of Amran. So what's important is that all these groups that Joseph has talked about, the Sheshemites or Sukkaim, the Kenites, who he says were Sheshemites, they're mentioned literally together in the Musnad inscriptions, in the Middle Sabian inscriptions of 1000 BC. Okay. And they actually lasted up until the medieval period when Al-Hamdani and other people talked about them. But in my book, you'll see that a lot of the Sheshemite people are still known by their names as well, like the Halik or Alekat, Alegat, the Legat. This name actually came across into North Africa. A lot of people don't know this. This is the first time I'm saying it. This name Legat was Lagwat, was in plural was Lagwatan, a name of an ancient Berber group. So it's just what I'm telling you is that the ancient peoples of Jordan and Sinai crossed over very early into Africa, became the peoples known as Libyans. Among those people known as Libyans, Tehenu, Temehu. Not all of them, but a large majority of the, especially the later peoples in Libya, the so-called Neo-Berbers of Libya, were these groups of people that were moved up from Hejaz and Canaan. And that is why the Berbers claim descent from Canaan. Or that's one of the reasons, because that was, like I said, the later Neo-Berbers, so-called Neo-Berbers. Okay, so this part I'm not going to go into because that's more detailed. I'm going to be putting this up on academia.com for people to peruse. All right, so okay, so Marzuk, you were here. I just wanted to ask, do you remember what the name Bela or Bali stood for in the, or how was it represented in the Bible?
It's Bela, and let's see.
And
And that was supposed to be one of the five main tribes of the Moabites. Is that correct?
well, they were definitely Moabite people. They claimed
Okay.
they had
Okay.
a, in shoot, hold on, I messed up my book. In the Gar area in the colonial period, they had a group called the Children of Lut, or the sons, children of Lot. And and they were the ones that broke the Moabite stone. They're closely related to the Hamada tribe, which I also talked about in other, well, here in the book and as well as other Zoom meets as the Hamathites.
Oh, okay.
All these people, the Kenite or Hamathites, remember,
Yes.
they're all closely related people.
Yes, from
And the
behind.
Helikites, as I said, too, are these people called Halik or Elegat, tribe of the Hivite or Hoetat people. The Hoetat people who claim descent from Hoet bin Ibn Ham, and who also came from the Tahama originally. Does anybody know where the Tahama was?
Wasn't that a mountainous region?
Well,
Tiana?
the Asir is in the Tahama, and that's a mountainous region, but
Okay.
what else? Tahama was in Southwest Arabia. It was the area of,
The Hejaz.
well, Hejaz is also part of, or
And I know Yathrib and well, the Canaanite area or
yeah,
Kenana.
land of the Kanana tribe, and the plain of called plain of Kenania, and the Wadi of Kanona, plural for Kanana. Yes. So the Tahama is in Southwest Arabia, and all these people that I'm talking about originate in Southwest Arabia. This area of Southwest Arabia is also known as, in ancient times, before historical times, is what archaeologists call the Sabir or Afro-Tahama culture, Afro-Tahama civilization, or the Afro-Arabian civilization. And this is where Canaan and Israel and Moab and Edom arose. Okay, so basically, that's what all I'm going to cover tonight is that the Qara tribe. Can you say anything about the Qara, Martin? Martin?
You ask, is that open question or is
Yeah.
that for anybody? You know, one of us here. Well, the miners, they are also they are Canaanites, and they're Quraysh, and they're of the clan of Khuzaima,
Yes.
Baal. And
What do we have? Ibn Khuzaimah? Yes.
Ludraka, Madrika.
Well, what's important about you saying, what's important about saying Mudrika? Why are you telling me that? Mudrika was the ancestor of, it was the father of Khuzaimah. So Khuzaimah was the father of two people. Who?
Elias, no,
Well, yeah. Well, Ilyas was actually the father of Mudrika. Good. You're close. Mudrika is also the father of Hudhail or Huzail. Hudhail ibn Mudrika, and we said Charles Doughty in his Travels in Arabia, or whatever the name of the book was, said those people have black and shining skins. They had a clan among them called the Lahian, from which comes the name of the Lahianites, the ancient Lahianites that took over Dedan from the Dedanites or Dedan people. And so, but the main thing about Khuzaimah is that he's father of Alhoun or Alhoun ibn Khuzaimah and Kanana ibn Khuzaimah. Alhoun, the other name of Alhoun, I said was.
There.
It's hard to remember that, I know that part. But we're talking about the tribe of Qahtan.
Qahtan.
The tribe of Qahtan was who? The court, no, the head. I'm sorry, the head of Qahtan. Who did the colonials say were the head tribe of Qahtan?
Joktan and Shem.
No.
No.
Qahtan was son of Shem, but the
Some
tribe we're
Shem.
talking, the main tribe I'm talking about, who am I pointing to now?
You're talking about the Qara, right? Okay.
So the Qara are otherwise known as Al-Hon ibn Khuzaimah.
Zaima, yes. I got it right here. I'm looking
Al-Hon. So
at it. Okay.
Hun is the name of the son of Khuzaimah. And
Okay.
Kinana is another name of the son. Quraysh comes from Kunana. The son of the brother of Khuzaimah is Hudhail. Okay. The name Kinana, of course, became Canaanite, and that's why the Canaanites are called black. They are black. They're still black. And I said the Canaans still live in Gaur, or the area south of the Dead Sea, where a lot of the black people live, and they're trying to make them into slaves and stuff like that. And what was important about the Qara is that they're historical people, and I had talked about how they were especially known for the Qara tribe, were especially known for their archery.
Oh, the archers, yeah, the Bayon and Kara.
And also, they were on both sides of the Red Sea. A
Yes.
lot of the tribal names, including the Sab, the Makir, the Esau, or Esau, as they're called in the Bible, the
Dancing traders.
Tamim, no, the Qara are the Tamim as well, or Tamim. The Bible knows Timan, Timan. The ancient Greeks called them Timanitai. The ends in trading people are the Afar Katira, the people that took over Troglodyte Ethiopia, or the cave-dwelling people of Ethiopia, who are these Qara Mara people who still dwell in caves in Oman and places like that. When I say caves, of course, we're talking again about places where they have their sheep and cattle, very, very large ravine, ravenous areas, ravine areas in mountains. You know, we're not talking about a small cave. We're talking about large caverns where the people live during certain seasons. So those were the Arabian troglodytes, otherwise known as Ethiopian troglodytes. We said that both sides of the Red Sea were occupied by the same exact people, including the Madij people, whose tribes include the Marad, the Jabir or Yabir, the Az people also were actually a branch of the Madij. The Hamdan people were a branch of the Madij. The Hamdan in further north are called Hamada. And as I said, those were the people also called Hamathites. They're people that are associated with mining. So the Kenites also are associated with mining. In the south, they're called the Kani or Kane. And that's why I said I keep bringing up the connection with Africans and the Kano, like the Kano has the same root, the name Kano. And the Kani, which is a tribe of or clan of the Soninke. Still a clan of the Soninke. So basically, that's what, you know, and I had published already someplace on here where the, not published, but posted, where colonialist writers said that the Qara were not only the head of the Qahtan, but the same groups as known as Esau. You know, they had clans among them that were basically the clans we know as Horites or descendants of Edom, the Esau people. So Jaishan was another name of the one of the, another clan of these Qara people. And the Qara were, of course, described as two peoples by the colonialists. You remember which ones, Mr. Marzu? Marzu? Well, who, which African people did they compare them to? Like Bertram Thomas, he talked about the Qara looking like.
The order Ethiopian is one of them.
Not really. Well, he was more specific than that. He said the Beja.
Oh, yeah, the Beja.
Yeah, and he, and the other people were told, said the Somalis.
Yeah.
So at that time, which is not long ago, 200 years ago, the Qara tribes still resembled the tribes that are known by the same name in Africa. As I said, Esau is a major tribe in Djibouti, major Somali tribe in Djibouti. And Esau is the name of who in the Bible? According to the Arabs, Esau is the name of who in the Bible?
The father of the Arabs, son of Abraham. No, son of Isaac, Jacob's twin.
Yeah, but what's his name?
Esau.
The name, well, the name is Esau.
Yeah.
Esau. Yeah, and it's also, he's all, otherwise known as Edom. Yes, Edom. And as I said, that name is connected to the name of the Yemenite Jelf, which is known as Adumu. 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 Okay. And lastly, I just want to co repeat again what Ibn Khaldun said about the purity of these tribes, such as Quraysh, Kanana, Huthael, and their Khuza neighbors, because actually the Khuza were closely related to the Huthael on the maternal side, and their main tribe was the Ahabish. The Ahabish of Hejaz, whose name became Habashia or Hupshia. And that's where the name of the Abyssinian, that's where they get their name, because those people settled in Africa. Anyway, let's see. So Ibn Khaldun considered the purest of the Arabs. He said, their pedigrees can be trusted not to have been mixed up and corrupted. They have been preserved pure in unbroken lines. This is the case, for instance, with the Mudar tribes such as Quraysh, Kanana, Thaqif, Banu Asad, which were of Kanana, the Huthael, and their Khuza neighbors. Khuza or Khaza is the name of Hazo in the Bible. They lived, and Huthael is the name of an ancient name of the king, Huzail or Hazael. They lived a hard life in places where there was no agriculture or animal husbandry. They lived far from the fertile fields of Syria and Iraq, far from the sources of seasoning and grains. How pure have they kept their lineages? They are unmixed in every way and are known to be unsullied. That's from the Al-Muqaddimah. Muqaddimah, right? And we just said that colonial, even in colonial times, the Huthael are described as having shining black skins. The Quraysh are said to be dark, and they said that, and the reason why they're still dark, well, they're not said to be, they're still dark in places like Sinai and Jericho, as I've said. Yarashas are called. They're still dark, they claim, because they never mixed with, outside of their clan. The Kanana, of course, became the legendary Canaanites, known for their black skins. Okay, so all these groups are the pure Arab peoples. Even though, they belong to the Mudar, who are said to be Northern Arabs and adopt Arabs by adoption, they're really the original Arabs. Along with Qahtan, who are the Arab of the Arabs, they are the Qahtan who, they are in fact the Qahtan. And all that stuff about Northern Arabs and Southern Arabs actually comes from these Ajam people or Abna people, Central Asian people who, as I said, started colonizing around the time of Christ, different parts of the Yemen or the coastal area of the Yemen as merchants, and then later on were called in by Muhammad and other people to fight against the Medes and other pure Arab tribes. That's why you find this. They actually were the first Muslims. These foreign people were the first Muslims in Yemen. And they became the great landowners in Yemen. And that's why you find today, these people claiming to be, all kinds of Hamdan tribes, because they actually were intermixed with the Hamdan Confederation, which was actually a branch of Madij, like the Az. So, as I said, a lot of the stuff you will find out, you're the first to learn, and I'll be putting it online on the academic sites. So I don't know if you guys saw what I put up. No, I think you did, Marzouk, but I just want to repeat. So if you see me dismissing certain people, it's because I'm feeling like they're not respecting what's happening on the Facebook page. Okay, so I had to get rid of this guy that was talking about Qahtan and the Arabing being basically the original Arabing mulattoes and stuff like that. I just got rid of him. And that's what's going to be, the case from now on. Because the point is to try to get rid of all the rhetorical fallacies, folk history that Eurasian people and Middle Eastern people made up about the original Semitic people who were African Asiatics, not people in, from Turkey and Syria and all these other places. Anyway, okay, so I put up what the writer of the foreword of my book said, which I was actually crying about this today because I didn't realize he had said this. It says, not unlike the scholarship of Robertson Smith, okay, he was a colonial Orientalist historian, Dr. Marnish's work may be met with resistance, but also is to be credited with marking a significant stage in the study of religion. That is something that, that's one of the best comments I've ever gotten. And I've got a lot of good comments, gotten a lot of
Some
good comments.
change.
And that, so that's why I'm happy that I'm able to post on academia, because a lot of scholars from all over the world come there, from the top universities in the world. And I'm really bringing it to Facebook just to get my thoughts together, not for people that don't know what they're talking about to come and, spout their opinions that they read somewhere online. And half the stuff, it's funny, half the stuff that people come with, they're coming back to argue and to sometimes debate me about with my own, with stuff that I already put online. That's the funny stuff. They don't even bother to They don't even bother to read who it, who put it online. And they took something out of context and they're coming back to argue with me about some point. So that's what's just funny and ironic. And I just say, okay. And if they don't understand what they're doing, then I just get rid of them because I don't have, I don't want a lot of nonsense put on the page. So, but anyway, anybody have any questions?
I don't, it's a new, it's more to study. I'm starting to retain a lot more, but I got a ways to go. It's coming though.
Okay. Now just try to read also what I keep putting online too about the, each, I try to start talking in the Zoom meets about what I'm putting online during the week. So,
Yes.
for example, here I talk about the Adal and Akar again, and the Adal who are also in Somalia, and how they belong to Al-Hun ibn Khuzaimah and part of the Ahabish, and people Ahabish of Hijaz who people have tried to say were black Abyssinian slaves, that kind of thing. All right, so
Right.
thank you guys for coming again.
Thank you for teaching us.
Much, and please hang in there if I'm not coming every week. I'm going to try to come as much as possible. So, but you'll get
It's always a pleasure.
thank you so
Yes.
much, and
We'll
I'll
see
try
you
to.
the next time.
Yeah, try to put it up online tonight.
Okay.
Thank you. Namaste.
Right. Bye.
Okay. Bye-bye. Salaam alaikum.